Pearl.
Clayton.
Pearl.
Clayton.
Pearl.
Oh, God, Clayton,
what?
You're killing me, Clayton.
Pearl.
Clayton, I want you to remember. Clayton. Oh, your poor mother, Clayton.
Pearl.
God, don't yell, Clayton. You're killing me, Clayton.
When loving lovers love.
Clayton, Clayton.
This is On Hold with Atchka. I'm your host, Shannon. And today we have a very enjoyable interview with Mary Jo Pehl, who played Pearl in the greatest show ever, Mystery Science Theater 3000, and is now playing herself in Joel Hodgson's bastard MST Love Child, Cinematic Titanic, which is both on DVD at cinematictitanic.com, and they're doing live shows across the country, including some in Seattle, Ann Arbor, San Francisco, LA, Anaheim, Boston, Newark. Go to cinematictitanic.com to check it out. But for now, enjoy this visit with Mary Jo Pehl.
All right, well, let's get started.
Certainly.
Okay. I'm speaking with Mary Jo Pehl, the modern-day Renaissance woman. She's a comedian, author. She's written a book called I Lived With My Parents and Other Tales of Terror, as well as numerous articles and NPR pieces. And she's a performer, best known as Pearl Forrester, mother of Clayton Forrester in the incredible show Mystery Science Theater, the Peabody Award-winning show Mystery Science Theater 3000. Also played Magic Voice and several other roles before taking on Pearl. And she's Catholic, so, you know, you're okay in my book.
Okay, glad to hear it.
So, and currently you're performing with Cinematic Titanic, a lot of
That's
the alumni from Mystery Science Theater.
Right.
And so how's that going? How's Cinematic Titanic going?
Oh, it's great. It's been a really interesting process for me personally, because it's a artist-owned and operated endeavor. So we're all making the decisions. We're all trying to figure out how to proceed without the backing of a network or a major sponsor. And so, you know, it's really called me to sort of hone some business acumen, which I have none of, but it's been a real learning process, and we're just having a ball. I mean, I love those guys, and our shows are wonderful, if I do say so myself. So
I can verify, I can vouch for that. I've been to one of your live shows. I've seen all of the DVDs you guys have sent out. You guys are definitely hitting your stride, and it's really enjoyable. I should actually explain for people who aren't familiar. Mystery Science Theater and Cinematic Titanic is where you and your co-performers watch terrible, lousy Z-grade movies and just make fun of them, just rip them apart.
Mm-hmm.
And that started with Mystery Science Theater. Let's go back to the beginning. What were you doing before Mystery Science Theater?
I was doing stand-up comedy and temping to support that lifestyle, and that's how I met Trace, Joel. Well, I think everybody I met in the stand-up comedy scene in Minneapolis in the late 80s, early 90s, and I had just come off, the mid-80s, where I was trying to get a job in the corporate world and not realizing that that was not meant to be. I just don't have that sensibility, I guess. I don't know how to make that work, going to a 9-to-5 job. And I was really, really fortunate. I started doing stand-up comedy and started doing getting gigs right away. And I had to supplement it with temp work, but I realized that that was just a better fit for me.
Mm-hmm. So how did you met Trace and Joel through stand-up comedy. Mm-hmm. And what did you think when they first came to you and said, we've got this puppet show that we want you to join?
Well, actually, it was Mike Nelson. I had met Mike, Bridget, Frank, and Josh, Joel, Trace. I just want to make sure I covered everybody. Doing stand-up, and Bridget called me, and I was good friends with Bridget, and Bridget called me one day, and I think they had just been picked up by the Ha Channel or Comedy Central, and she called me and she said, "You didn't hear it from me, but Mystery Science Theater is looking for another writer. And I had never seen the show. I didn't have cable. I couldn't afford a TV.
Nobody had cable back then.
No, I know, but I couldn't even afford a TV. But, you know, probably for the best. And, you know, and I knew Mike. I adored Mike. He's a terrific guy. But I mustered up all my courage and called him and asked him if I could at least audition for it. And they brought me in for a couple of weeks, and then they forgot I was there. Seriously, you know, this sort of trial period was coming to a close, and nobody said anything. And I was really devastated, and I went to Mike, and I said, well, I just want to thank you for the opportunity. And he kind of looked at me like, oh, so they had a closed-door meeting, and they asked me to stay on another 2 weeks. And seriously, I think it just sort of segued into, I just kept showing up.
It's that Midwestern politeness, too polite to ask you to leave this day.
Sadly, just, seriously, yes, yes.
Just hang out with us.
Yes.
So what was that like? Like working on, I mean, the dynamic of Mystery Science Theater was amazing because it's a Midwestern TV show. It's so rare in entertainment today. Mm-hmm. What was it like to like be able to kind of foster your own entertainment field?
You know, Shannon, I'll tell you what, I'm really bad at sort of big picture ideas. My own perception is it was just such a treat to not have to move to Los Angeles or New York for me personally. I was kind of a scaredy cat at that point in my life. I think it was really exciting that we got to bring to bear our Midwestern sensibilities. You watch TV all the time. I'm of a certain age where all the TV I watch, everything took place in New York or Los Angeles, and those seemed very exotic places. Mm-hmm. And we got to promulgate a sort of Midwestern sensibility. We got to make local Midwestern jokes. So that was, it was fun, and it was kind of, subversive. Mm-hmm. We got to put that out there. It was great.
Yeah, and it definitely comes through. It's definitely a very Midwestern show, very, very homey. And I guess one of the most important questions, I think, that people want to know about Mystery Science Theater and the people that you worked with was, who has the most mispronounced name? You, Trace Beaulieu, see, I think I just screwed up his name, Jim Malone or Mike Nelson?
Well, it's Jim Malone, first of all.
See, I've already proven the point.
You know, I'm sorry, Shannon, I rarely hear Jim's name mispronounced.
Really?
I don't want to put you on the spot or anything. No.
Well, it's okay. I'm kind of dumb, so it's all right.
Well, yeah, I noticed that. I wasn't going to say anything, but...
it's kind of you. Midwestern sensibility. There you go.
Yes. And Mike Nelson, very funny.
Thank you. Thank you.
You know, Carl, I don't know. Maybe Trace would dispute this, but I would say my name is invariably mispronounced. His is invariably misspelled. I can't believe the ways we've seen it spelled. So.
Well, yeah, yours seems so straightforward. It looks like Pehl. It looks like P-E-H-L. It looks like you should be able to just, you know, hey, Pehl, Mary Jo Pehl.
Yeah, but it's Danish, so it's got that long E-H sound.
Okay. You have a lot in common with Dick Cheney, then, because Diane Rehm nailed him down. I'm sorry.
Oh, God. Oh, hold on. I have to... What is this in my back? Oh, it's a big knife placed there by Shannon. Oh, God.
Well, it's actually pronounced Cheney, so that's the only thing you have in common. As far as I know, you haven't tortured anybody.
Oh, no. I didn't know that.
Today. So. Yeah, it was on... anyways, Diane Rehm dug that up, so... I just thought I'd share that. So, my
thank you.
Dick Cheney trivia for the day.
I
have like one nugget each day like to hand out. So. So what was the transition like from, you know, you were a writer from what season would it have been? You said high comedy channels like the second season.
I started about the fourth show into season 4, I think.
Okay.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And so then from there, I mean, you did performing as Magic Voice, but you started stepping into the role of Pehl in season 7. So you had quite a run as a writer, mostly.
Mm-hmm.
So what was it like to transition into a performer?
Well, it was really nerve-wracking. First of all, I think my big concern was I felt like I was working with the most amazing, funniest, smartest people in the world, and you really want to be able to hold your own mm-hmm. with the people you respect, right? Mm-hmm. Secondly, this was during the ascendancy of the internet, and forums and chat groups were blossoming, and it was very difficult and disconcerting to me to note all the furor about me stepping in, having a greater role, and then when Trace left and I was the head nemesis, that was a lot difficult to realize that people could be so mean about the whole thing. It was very dispiriting, and then I realized I have this great job, and I'm really lucky, and I am not going to let anyone else take that away from me. And when I realized that, I was much clearer about being able to go in and do the best job I could. I don't know if everyone will agree that I was especially great at the job, but, you know...
Well, I enjoyed your performances.
Well, thanks, you know. Plus, let's remember it's a TV show and it's a silly role.
Right.
So, you know, so my point is, Shannon, is like I really learned to keep it in perspective.
And
I mean, technically it was very difficult for me because when I am nervous, I cannot, and I'm not joking about this and I'm not proud of it, but when I am nervous or I'm overthinking it, I can't walk and say lines at the same time. That was very challenging for me.
Very stationary performer.
Yes.
Okay.
Focus on the lines because I have to get those out, and then I will make a gesture.
Well, and to put it in perspective, you know, as far as the transition and how people reacted, people went apeshit when, you know, when Josh left and Tom took over, you know, and it was so early, people were calling
in. You mean Kevin?
I'm sorry, who did I say?
Tom.
Yeah, Tom Servo took over for Josh.
Right.
And so people went crazy about Kevin and hated his performance. And then when Mike took over for Joel, it was the same thing.
Yeah, so yeah, you're right.
You're in good company. Yeah.
Okay, good to know.
Yeah, so
I appreciate that.
No problem. So when MST ended, I mean, it was you guys kind of saw it coming in season 10 from what I've talked to everybody else. So you kind of had this, you know, what are we going to do next? What were you anticipating after MST?
I had an immediate plan. And that was, I had saved a lot of money, and I just wanted to travel for a year, and so I did. And then after that, part of my plan was to move to New York after that. And I always assumed that I'd keep writing in some way. Mm-hmm. When I moved to New York, I was really hoping to get on a cable network writing for some show, but that never panned out.
So, where did you travel in when you went traveling?
Oh, I went to Morocco, Turkey, Egypt, Western Europe a couple of times, Costa Rica, China. I'm trying to think. There's another place. Oh, Peru. I was just all over.
Wow.
Yeah, it was great.
That does sound nice. So then. You did quite a bit of writing in between. You had your book. You had several articles and NPR pieces. And that, I'm trying to think of like you had that until Cinematic Titanic. What did you think? Did you think you would be getting back into riffing, riffing?
Oh no.
No.
No. Yeah.
Mm-mm. I mean, even though I spoke with Joel, and I know that an MST reboot was in the works for a little while.
Yeah, and that's something that I wasn't privy to. I only know that anecdotally from Joel and Trace having met with Jim Mallon. Oh, I'm just funning you.
It's okay.
So I wasn't in on those initial talks, okay. running that up the flagpole. But no, Absolutely no idea. And then a couple of years ago, Joel contacted me. I was visiting friends in L.A. doing a play in Los Angeles, and Joel sent me an email, and I hadn't heard from him in quite some time, and asked if I'd like to have lunch with him and Frank. And nothing during over lunch, nothing ever came out up about this. I had no idea anyone was meeting with anybody else about anything. And then a couple of months later, Joel called me and floated the idea by me. Hmm.
And what did you think when he brought it up?
Well, I hate to admit this, but I'm kind of short-sighted. I'm very sort of I leap and hope the net will be there. But I had this opportunity to work with Trace and Joel and Frank and Josh again. I was thrilled, you know. I think being a writer is a very solitary trade, and I enjoy that part of it. I think finding a collaboration that works is a really tricky thing. But I knew I would be really challenged by this, by people who were funnier and smarter than me, and who doesn't want to work with people like that so you work better, you know?
Right, right.
So in short, I was absolutely thrilled, because in this kind of job, working with those kind of people, you know whatever's happening, you're going to laugh really hard.
Well, I just like to say, personally, I prefer to work with people that are stupider and slower.
Well, yeah, really, sure.
It improves your odds of being recognized.
No, and I should add, you know, people who are like that, who also are really terrific people. That
right.
Doesn't always work if they're jackasses.
Yeah, intelligent jackasses aren't fun to work with.
Yes, precisely.
So, are you happy to be pouring through terrible movies again?
Yes. What's not to like?
I don't know. The terrible movies? That Alien Factor, the most recent one. Oh, my gosh.
Oh, I know it's bad.
It was
but
painful.
I have a soft spot in my heart for that.
The movie itself, like, it didn't even need riffing. It was so funny. It was.
I know. Isn't it great?
But you guys really added a lot of color to it. It's great. So, what is the difference? What is the difference that you sense between, I guess, maybe writing and performing for Mystery Science Theater versus Cinematic Titanic?
Well, for one thing, I am actually performing with Cinematic Titanic.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of riffing and being
right.
being with the movie. Secondly, there's a great deal of personal and emotional investment, because I'm working with everyone else, not for other people. So there's that aspect to it. Another dimension is that we're all in different locations, so we continue to learn and struggle with how we can collaborate best from remote locations, and that's been an interesting process. Have I answered your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I'm just trying to think of all the...
If I said no, what would you say then?
I would say, what was the question again? Because, you know, I'll just start going off.
I'll just let you keep going. That's
no.
Well, have you guys tried Skyping? Because that's pretty popular.
Our problem is that we also need to be able to, we do telephone conference calls a lot of times, but we've looked into ways to write the movies online together, and there's no system out there that can address that, where we're all looking at a movie and can stop and start the movie.
Huh. Well, maybe you guys could create something. Hey, Joel's an innovator.
He's... Oh, like we don't already have enough to do.
Oh, come on. If you really wanted to, you could do it.
Oh, please.
Well, do you prefer the live performances or studio?
The live performance, I think one thing that we have really learned is that we all have this stand-up comedy background, and we adore that that interaction, that connection. There's nothing like being able to respond to it, being able to work your chops. It's kind of in the blood of all of us. So we when we recorded the live shows at the Largo, a couple months ago, we also did a separate track before anyone was in the auditorium, where we just did the lines, and the idea was that we might be able to add that for people who might not want the live experience. Mm-hmm. When we listened to it, it just sounded very, very flat. Mm-hmm. There's something about doing it live that just gives it a lot of dimension and resonance, and we're having fun, and we love that the audience is having fun.
Mm-hmm. And it's, yeah, the last two DVDs you sent out have been live performances.
Right.
Versus, I mean, in the first, I guess, how many were the first seven, maybe, I guess, were kind of following a story arc.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Not to use that dreaded word. I apologize. I know story
arc. No, but we were working on that, absolutely.
And so are you guys going to return to the story arc, or will the future DVDs be live performances, or what do you have a plan?
You know, I don't know that we've really decided. We feel like the live DVDs have shown us at our best, mm-hmm. and they're certainly easier and cheaper to produce.
Oh, yeah,
And, you know, like I say, we're a company that is just getting by with the revenues we're getting, mm-hmm. you know, so that's definitely a consideration.
And you're, you know, you're kind of pioneering entertainment, internet entertainment, kind of.
Are we?
Yeah, you're pioneers.
Oh.
See, I should add that to your list of titles, Pioneer.
Oh God!
I mean, you guys are up there. In my opinion, you're up there with the Radiohead, you know, self-releasing their mm-hmm. CD. I mean, you're really taking responsibility for your product.
Right. Yes.
You're kind of innovating the path for future performers. So I mean, I think there's definitely time to experiment and stuff. So.
Yeah. Well, I like your spin on it, Shannon. I'm very short-sighted. I have blinders on. I just get into the groove. Like, okay, we're going to do this.
Well, and MST was definitely an innovator too. I mean, MST kind of coincided with the beginning of the internet, as you said. Mm-hmm. And you guys were there on like the, what do they call those things? The message board groups, like before there was like internet. The fans were really active on there. It was like really one of the first internet kind of coexistences with entertainment. So
yes, that's my perception, my understanding.
Yeah. So if anybody's, you know, poised to like change the entertainment field, it's you guys.
Oh, good.
So no pressure.
Oh yeah, thanks. I appreciate it.
No problem. So do you foresee a Mystery Science Theater reunion?
I don't, but I'm very short-sighted. I would have told you that the internet will never last.
It's just a fad.
Yes, I'm the one who, you know, thinks that floors are, you know, modernity that are ridiculous.
Give me the dirt.
Yeah, so I have no idea. I really don't. I kind of don't, but who knows?
So now I'd like to move on to the second part of the interview, which is I'd like to ask you about your experience as a fat woman.
Mm-hmm.
Growing up, have you been bigger all your life? Or,
yes.
Or you have? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So what was your experience growing up as a larger child?
Well, you know, I have so much to say, and I'm trying to make it cohesive and cogent.
Oh, don't worry about that. I can edit this later.
Okay. Well, you know, sad to say, the first thing I want to respond with is it was really shaming, mm-hmm. you know. I look at pictures of myself, and I was taller and pudgier, but I was not nearly the disaster the response from my surroundings would indicate. I think that, you know, my mother had a weight problem all her life, and I think she really panicked because she didn't want me to go through what she perceived herself as going through. I got pegged as lazy in Catholic school, which I think is just criminal in terms of we would never do that, or we try not to do that, or our society aspires not to peg people on what they look like.
Really? where did you grow up again?
No. I think I'm saying we aspire, or I think we pay a lot of lip service to,
yeah,
well, you
definitely
can't judge a book by its cover.
Right.
And I was very conscious of food and eating at a very early age, but without the proper tools. It was kind of a demented relationship without really knowing what, I mean, if you're given a limited menu, my family, both my parents worked, so it was a lot of frozen food, and you don't know what the proper choices are, but you're just shamed about what is available to you. It's a difficult, relationship.
Mm-hmm. So do you feel like, I mean, did your mom, like, try to keep you thin? I mean, did she try to help you stay thin, or how did she kind of try to influence your behavior?
Well, she was very critical of everything I ate, but I didn't know how to eat. I didn't know what responding to real hunger was. You can get really skewed about what your relationship to food is and what your relationship to hunger is. Does that make any sense?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And I'm just trying to sort out my thoughts here. She took me to a Weight Watchers meeting when I was 10 years old.
The hallmark of any lifelong fat person.
Yeah, and here's the thing. I love my mother dearly. I don't want to make her out to be some sort of horrible person.
No.
She had a limited understanding of it, too.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think she was doing the best she could, and she was trying to save me from the life that she experienced.
Right. And my wife, actually interviewed two or three podcasts ago about her experience, and her mom put her through the same thing, except her mom had an eating disorder, and she sent her to Weight Watchers when she was 7 because, she didn't know what else to do. She wanted to help her with her weight.
Right, exactly, yes.
And that just kind of, like, really stunted her from that point on, was, really screwed up her relationship with food.
Yes, and you also, you view everything through the prism of food and eating. Mm-hmm. And that's just not a healthy way to live. Mm-hmm. It's something I still struggle with.
Yeah, and so you we spoke earlier, and you said that you're familiar with health at every size.
Yes.
So was there like a long struggle with dieting? Were you one of those chronic dieters throughout your life?
Oh my God, yes, Shannon. Shannon, can I put you the phone down for just a second?
Sure.
I have to run to the ladies' room.
Oh, yeah. I did that right beforehand, so I understand.
Okay, I'll be 2 minutes.
Okay.
Just a moment.
No problem. Okay. I guess maybe while Mary Jo's gone, I should talk about her. Actually, I heard that Mary Jo Pehl is a big fan of Dick Cheney, that she was actually... one of the people pushing for Dick Cheney to run in 2012, the Cheney-Palin ticket. And I'm pretty sure that she's a Tea Party advocate, so,
Thank you. My apologies.
Oh, no problem. No problem.
So, absolutely. When I start out at Weight Watchers, and so you try and follow that program, and that was much more restrictive in those days. It wasn't, they haven't co-opted the sort of, it's not dieting, it's
lifestyle.
And it wasn't at that point yet. It was much more restrictive. I remember I forget what it was called. But I think it might have been an early version of Nutrisystems, but don't quote me on that.
Well, I'm going to have to.
Okay.
You're doing the interview live.
Oh, am I really?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh. Well, you said you could edit it out later.
No, I'm not. I can, but I choose not to.
Well, you're not going to include my going to the bathroom, are you?
Yeah. Actually, I talked about you while you were gone, so.
You asshole. Are you serious? Very funny.
Okay, I hope you've enjoyed the first half of On Hold with Atchka and Mary Jo Pehl. Right now I'd like to share one of my favorite Pearl scenes in Mystery Science Theater. It's a little long, but it is one of her best performances, in my opinion.
Hey, William, here's a plane. That's pretty annoying.
Warning, danger.
You guys, you know what? Pearl asked us to pull this over so we could find out where we are, and I'm trying to do a really tricky docking maneuver, so why don't you go watch a video with Gypsy, huh?
Oh, video?
Free Willy, Mondo Connie.
Mondo Connie, cool.
There you go.
Yeah, okay. All right, here we go. Now, this is the hard part. Just ease it into place. Gently dock with the other ship. It's perfect. I'll go check it out.
Nelson? Mike? Is that you? Come on over here, neighbor.
You sure it's not too late?
I'll be up another couple of hours or so. Come on over. I just put a fresh pot of coffee on.
Just float on over here, Pearl.
Oh, shh. Hang on. I just put Bobo down, and sometimes he's a little fussy.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
Ooh. Oh, boy. She's a cold one tonight.
Yeah, huh? Supposed to get down to absolute zero. That's why I always wear a sweater.
Yeah. Ooh. So, Pearl, how come you're so evil?
I'm filled with hate. I don't know if that helps.
Yeah, it does, yeah.
You know, Mike, people can be awfully judgmental about evil.
Mike! Mike! You know, we were watching TV, and we had it on something we all liked, and then Servo changed the channel.
Okay, well, I'll tell you what. If you're real quiet, you can stay here with Pearl and me, okay?
Hey, Art.
Hi.
Well, I suppose I better be sending you guys your movie, huh?
Oh, see, that's another thing. You said you weren't going to send us any more movies.
You know, sometimes I think I lie because I'm evil.
So... you are going to send us a movie, though, huh?
Yeah, and it's pretty bad. I hope that's okay.
That's all right.
It was made in Vermont, and it's about this guy who travels through time, and then he has to go back in time to change what he did in the future. It's called Time Chasers. Oh, it's got that guy in it. Oh, and that other guy, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah,
I think we're going to get back there. Why don't you take off?
Well, hey, buddy.
Whoa.
Thanks for stopping by.
Yep.
Art, you take care, kid.
Bye.
Oh, hey, Mike.
Yeah?
I despise you and all you stand for, and you'll never escape. You know the rest.
Yeah, I sure do. Good night, Pearl.
He's a good kid.
No way.
Come on, Servo.
No.
Turn it back to Dr. Jane Seymour Medicine Quinn.
No, no way. Forget you. What? Hey, where were you guys? Hey, did Pearl get to go over to Pearl's? That's not fair.
Pearl gave me lots of candy and popcorn and said that I could stay there anytime. That she was going to take me to France and she liked me best. And then
oh,
I could
play
movie dress
side.
And
women's
clothes whenever I wanted.
Talk, man.
Oh, okay, I can edit it if you wanted to. Most people would, I think, you know, like the full raw cut, you know, but yeah.
Oh, no, and my only issue is with, I don't mind denigrating diet programs.
Uh-huh.
I just don't like being inaccurate.
Oh, I understand completely.
Because I can't remember the name of it, but
That's
it was
okay.
Some sort of 500 calorie a day diet.
Mm-hmm. Ooh.
Yes, and... It's so weird. I feel like I'm talking about the Dark Ages because that was perfectly acceptable. You wanted to achieve that. And I remember going through that in my 20s and losing a lot of weight. And then you try to sort of lead a normal lifestyle. And, of course, you're going to put it back on. But we didn't know all that then. We know so much more
right
now. And I remember... doing programs, self-imposed programs, like when I was in college, I would go periods where I would just eat one granola bar a day.
Wow.
And as much tab as I could drink. And I felt like I was going mental. Well, I didn't know, you know, I had no sense of what caffeine could do to you on an empty stomach.
Yeah.
So, of course, I felt like I was imploding because I had one... one, you know, Nature Valley granola bar a day in, you know, 7 to 10 tabs.
Yeah.
So there was that. And I remember one point when I was doing some sort of 500-calorie-a-day thing, and I was doing laundry, and I started to pour whisk into the little measuring cup. And when the whisk was coming out, my mouth started watering. And it's blue. You know what I mean? So it was just sort of, I just had this crazy realization of the whole fucked upness. My mouth is watering because I'm looking at laundry detergent.
Maybe you had developed pica.
Maybe.
Did you start, like, licking dust off of cars and stuff?
No.
Because I can imagine being that hungry that you would, like, you know, pick up a rock and
well,
gnaw on it.
Absolutely. You can kind of see that descent, right?
Yeah.
So, and then somewhere along the line, I want to say maybe my late 20s or early 30s, I read, somebody recommended a book by Janine Roth. Mm-hmm. And I'm telling you, it blew my mind. It really shifted my relationship, if you will, to food. I didn't know you could look at food that way. Mm-hmm. You know, it either had to be an acrimonious relationship or sort of Stockholm syndrome relationship. So it really shifted my way of looking at it, and it really went a long way for me making some peace with who I am and what I am and how I will enjoy food. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, all these cravings I had honestly just sort of went away when I started realizing, I don't like how that tastes when I think of it. You know, it really shifted a lot of things for me.
You became more in control of your appetite and your hunger.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And understanding what it was, because I honestly don't think I'd ever allowed myself to have an organic hunger.
And it almost seems like the diet industry wants to sabotage that, because that kind of feeds into their agenda.
Say more about that.
What do you mean?
Say more like what you're thinking about.
Well, you know, as long as people have disordered relationships with food.
Yes, right.
You know, then people are going to go through these weight cycles where they're, you know, they're binging binging and then restricting themselves, and then they go through these weight fluctuations, and, you know, they think that their body's out of control because they don't know how to eat, so they go on a diet and restrict
right.
their food further, and it just kind of, the more they fail, the more they go back to these regimens to try and fix the problem.
Yes.
So,
because I think you're absolutely right.
So it just seems like they thrive best when people don't know how to eat right.
Oh, absolutely. And I think people are always looking for some sort of paternalistic structure in being told what to do. Mm-hmm. If I go to this meeting, if I am told to eat this, I can give over to that. Mm-hmm. Someone else is the boss of me, mm-hmm. instead of really listening to what's going on with themselves. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I'm reading a book by Ellen Satter, who's a nutritionist, talking about children, how to feed children healthy, and basically she says that, you know, a parent who tries to make their child, I have two kids who one's really thin and one's chubby, and, you know, the chubby one loves to eat and the thin one doesn't, and you know, if I try to restrict the chubby one from eating and try to encourage the thin one, well, then I'm putting control on them, is according to her view, is that they're suddenly listening to my controls rather than their body's controls.
Wow, right.
It's really interesting.
Yeah, I can't imagine. I try to imagine it for myself if I were a parent, and when I think about what my mother tried to do mm-hmm. with me, I can only sympathize or empathize with her struggle because I don't know how I would do it. I don't
know
how I would not pass off or pass down my craziness about food.
Right.
Especially in the current environment.
Right. Exactly. And according to this the book I'm reading, it's that everything that people try to do in order to influence their child's weight does exactly the opposite.
Oh, sure. I'm living proof of it.
Yeah, and so many women are. So many men are, too.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
You know, living in an environment of trying to change who they, you know, biologically and genetically are supposed to be.
Mm-hmm.
And in the end, they kind of screw up their regulatory system and end up, you know, typically heavier than they probably would have ended up otherwise.
Yeah, and I think, absolutely, and I think there's emotional and psychic toll to it mm-hmm. as well.
Definitely.
Yeah, wow.
There's a lot going on here.
Yeah.
So you said that you read the book by Janine Roth and mm-hmm. in your 20s. Was that about the time that you were doing stand up?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So how did weight affect your performance both in like stand up comedy? Like let's start with stand up comedy. Is a lot of people who are fat comedians or comedians kind of use their weight as a crutch to you know provide material basically.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Did you use your weight in that way or how did you approach it?
You know, I only had two jokes about it. It was my opening joke, and I would just stand there and wait for the applause to die down, and I would introduce myself and say, "I am a recovering anorexic." And then as my act developed, I came up with another brief bit about how, you know, I was always struggling with my weight. I never made it like the axis of my mm-hmm. my stand-up because I hated that,
mm-hmm.
For myself anyway. And I would, the other joke was something to the effect of, you know, I'm always struggling with my weight, but I'm moving more towards self-acceptance and enjoying life, and I have found that 6 or 7 donuts first thing in the morning really curbs my appetite, you know? Pardon?
Takes the edge off.
Yes, exactly. Which, you know, now that I repeat it to you, Shannon, I think, well, that's one of those things that just sort of perpetuates the notion that that fat people are insatiable. I just liked it because it was so preposterous,
yeah.
You know, but I'm not sure that everyone else is keyed into my idea of preposterousness. And then the rest of my act was never about that because I did not want to walk on stage, and I think there was a little bit in me that wanted to challenge people's notions that I was going to get up there and just rag on how ugly and fat I was.
Mm-hmm.
And I was definitely coming of age, comedy age, in an era where people, women especially, always joked about their appearance. I'm too ugly to date. I'm so fat. I'm so, which is a classic hallmark of a lot of women's comics, like Toadie Fields and Joan Rivers, just for starters.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a whole psychology to that, which I can bore you with later. But and I did a little bit of it because I have no problem laughing at my foibles. We all have them. Oh, God, what was the question? Where are we going with
this? I'm not sure. Self-deprecation, you know.
Oh, and how I use it in comedy.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And I remember being on the road with somebody, and I don't know how it came up, but when you're on the road with people, you're in the car together, and you're talking about everything as you drive eight hours to the next gig. And we were talking about that very idea. And the guy said to me, "No, you have to come on stage and address it." And my thinking was, "No, I don't. Why do I have to? Why do I have to give over to the audience's expectations?" And it's been really exciting for me to see people, these wonderful female comedians, who do not do that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like Janine Garofalo, Liz Winstead, really intelligent female comics who are not talking about their weight or their looks.
Right. And it's almost like it's become an expectation that women have to
mm-hmm.
be self-deprecating.
That's what I'm saying, exactly.
Yeah, and it's unfair for one thing. I mean, it you know, Do you think that audiences respond differently to that kind of self-deprecating humor versus kind of the general humor that you did?
I really couldn't tell you. I don't go to clubs very much anymore, except to see certain people like Dana Gould. Mm-hmm. I think I can just go on what my experience has been, not having done stand-up for many years. I think back in the day when I was doing it, there was a real comedy boom in the late 80s, early 90s. And thus, there were a lot more female comics coming out to do it. And I think the thinking back then was, way back in the olden days, was that, I mean, when I was doing it, Shannon, it was still a freak show. I would be introduced like this. Our next comedian is a female comedian.
Brace yourselves.
Yeah, like, okay, here comes the freak show, and that establishes a whole different set of expectations. Like, uh-oh. And it's always this thing of like, well, she's going to talk about tampons and having babies. As if the male point of view is the sort
default.
Of default social norm,
right?
You know? So I think a lot of women did it because they were still trying to figure out where they fit and what their material was going to be. And it definitely, I think there was a lot of pressure on female comedians to defuse that expectation because the feeling was that these audiences were unnerved, threatened by these ladies getting up there and being funny, because being on stage in front of people, being an only person, there's a lot of power in that. And a lot of audiences, and I think male audience members, do not want to have the woman be in charge. And when you're on stage doing comedy, you are in charge.
Mm-hmm. Do you think that female comedians get heckled more than male comedians, or?
Boy, I don't know. I think when I was doing it, I sure did. I mean, the things that would come out, you know, when you're doing it in Norfolk, Nebraska, you know, a small town and mostly known for its hog butchering plant, yeah, you're going to get heckled if you're a chick up there.
Because they've got room to talk.
Yeah, exactly.
With their hog butchering industry.
Yeah, well, again, you know, they're going to take the chick down a notch.
Yeah.
Like, you're not the boss of me. You know, I couldn't say, only anecdotally, quite possibly. Again, it's been really exciting to see the past couple generations of female comedians who are just straight out of the gate in charge and not going to let anybody do that.
Yeah. Were you pretty good at dealing with hecklers?
Oh, no, I was terrible.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh.
I would just say, like, shut up.
Leave me alone.
Yeah. Or I would just plow on, like I would just ignore them. You know, I'd love to go back and do it again, because now I'll take them on.
Yeah. Well, I'm curious then, you know, it seems like I did, you know, open mic nights briefly,
mm-hmm.
and kind of the funnest challenge was if you had a heckler, you know, who could, you know, shut them down the best.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think that when you were kind of like, you didn't respond, did that have to do with, you know, self-esteem, or how, like, why didn't you respond?
Because I had that paradox that exists in a lot of performers, in that you are very, can be very shy and introverted,
mm-hmm.
and yet find great expression and joy and power in being on stage.
Mm-hmm.
It's that dichotomy.
Yeah.
And I had my 25-minute routine. Mm-hmm. I think I was really scared to deviate from that. I knew exactly where the laughs were, and I just wanted to get off stage. I wanted to get on stage, and then I wanted to get off stage. And whether that comes from self-esteem, or I'm sure, absolutely, there's a confidence issue. I think if I were to do it now, I would feel so much more comfortable in my skin and being in command, and I don't know.
It reminds me of the song by the band called Stage Fright,
mm-hmm.
where it's all about the singer who just you know when he gets to get up on stage and sing, but you know as soon as he's done, he's out of there. He's you know.
Yep, absolutely, absolutely.
Yeah. So, well, I want to ask you about an issue that I read from time to time in blogs. But how do you feel about like fat jokes? And I want to bring that up in another context of Mystery Science Theater, because some of the funniest fat jokes I've ever heard were on Mystery Science Theater. I'm thinking like in particular of I don't know if you remember the Creeping Terror, where the grandfather and the grandson are fishing, and the grandfather looks kind of like a matryoshka doll. Somebody says he looks like a matryoshka doll.
Yes, yes.
And it's they put this fat person in a ridiculous situation, and it's hard not to laugh. So how do you feel about fat jokes in general?
That is a tough one, because I think, generally speaking, I think, how do I feel about fat jokes? In terms of Mystery Science Theater and Cinematic Titanic, we take off after everyone.
Mm-hmm.
No one escapes the riffing. Mm-hmm. So it's a level playing field. I am willing to laugh at myself,
mm-hmm.
and I think most people are willing to laugh at themselves, whatever their human foible is.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very tricky area, because there are some things that a person may be experiencing or be the victim of that aren't always funny, and yet day after day you find people who are really willing to talk honestly about things, and it ends up being funny.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's, not to be evasive, but I think it really depends. What I don't like is the part of what worked in Mystery Science Theater is being over the top,
mm-hmm.
perpetuating ridiculous stereotypes that whatever was on the screen was putting forth.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Okay, we heightened that to a ridiculous degree.
Like
that was our way of calling the director on
right.
what they were putting forth. The good girl, the girl in the tight sweater equals slut.
Right.
You know? So then we'd heighten that for comic effect.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I can live with that. I guess it's when it's not a joke
mm-hmm.
that I take issue with it, that people can use the word fat to encompass everything that our worst fears and stereotypes are about what fat is. I mean, that is such shorthand for lazy, overeating,
mm-hmm.
stupid.
Smelly. Don't forget smelly.
Smelly. Fat people, that's right.
Bathe.
We do smell, don't we?
Yeah, we never bathe.
Right.
I mean, I'm a big guy. I gave up long ago.
Well, right? Sure. Yeah. I mean, you know, I'm fat. What do you expect?
Yeah. Why take care of hygiene? You know?
Right.
It's overrated.
Yeah. So in it is contextual. It is mm-hmm. It can be case by case. You mentioned something about Janine Garofalo, who I'm sure speaks mm-hmm. much more eloquently to the issue than I can. What does she say about it?
She actually recently, was it Janine? It was somebody.
Or someone you mentioned, yeah.
Yeah, it was somebody was talking about how she thinks fat jokes are off limits, especially when it comes to women. And to a certain extent, I kind of agree that the fat women have kind of been the brunt of society's joke for so long that,
yeah.
you know, cut them some slack. Just let them, you know, I'm a fat guy. Make fun of fat guys. We can handle it, you know. We're allowed to be.
But you know what? You bring up a really interesting point in that you're absolutely right about the women fat jokes and male fat jokes. Men are allowed to use their fatness for humor.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, and well, just look at Saturday Night Live. I mean,
yeah.
Perfect example.
Right, and it's like, I don't know if you saw the article, I think it was in Slate, and I forget who it was by, but about the writer asking Kevin Smith to just come to terms with being fat, and hey, how about this? Try putting fat women in your movie.
Right.
You know?
Right.
So anyway, continue.
Oh,
about the fat jokes on about women being off limits.
It just seems like, well, it seems like even, but to me, it seems like you can still do fat jokes about women. A good example, my blog is Atchka, which comes from Incredible Melting Man, which at the very beginning has that nurse who's wearing that extremely tight uniform. She's a big lady, mm-hmm. and she's wearing that, like, skin-tight uniform.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And that in and of itself is funny. And you guys point out stuff about her weight, but it never seems cruel. It never
right.
seems like you're trying to, like, take her down a notch. And actually, I love that scene because then she goes running through that You Store It.
Yes, right.
She's like the first fat Jamie Lee Curtis.
I forgot that.
Yeah, it's just, and then she runs through that plate glass window. That's just like the most brilliant, I don't know. I love that movie.
Sure,
so
right.
It seems like intent is what really makes a fat joke acceptable or not acceptable.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Whether you're intending to hurt somebody or simply, you know, poke fun at a humorous situation.
Yeah, and that's always, can be difficult to suss out the difference.
Mm-hmm, definitely.
You know? I think as I've gotten older and in a place of more self-acceptance, I'm a little more forgiving when it's aimed at me, mm-hmm. because I can, first of all, I want to sort of defuse what fat means.
Mm-hmm.
It's an insult.
Mm-hmm.
Well, no, not if it's, I want to take back the word.
Mm-hmm.
It's
definitely.
It's just a fact, and it's one small dimension of all that I am.
You're fat, you're tall, you're, you know,
mm-hmm.
you're
blonde, I'm
blonde, yeah.
Funny, I'm, you know, sometimes smart, sometimes, you know, I'm just so many things, and I refuse to let other people make that an insult for me.
And yeah, that's a big thing of the fat acceptance movement is, you know, the word fat, it's ours. We're fatties. It doesn't hurt our feelings if you call us fat.
Right.
We are fat. We acknowledge it. It's not like, you know, it's not like until you told us we're fat, we were like, wait a second.
Yeah, take it back.
Yeah.
And that's what I mean about separating it out from all that is intended in that word.
Mm-hmm.
The slovenly, the mm-hmm. lazy. You know, the whole Kevin Smith thing has been really interesting to me. I really like that he called it like he did.
Mm-hmm.
And when it comes to, and I have followed the fat people flying thing pretty closely, and it just seems to me, what drives me crazy is in, oh my God, this is a whole separate hour. But it's very painful for me to go online and read responses to blog posts.
Oh, no kidding.
About, well, you just need to lose weight and blah, blah, blah.
Calories in, calories out.
And it's never that simple. People don't understand that the equation is not that simple.
No.
And that's not where I'm going with this. With the whole Kevin Smith thing, it's like, you've got to be kidding me. I mean, flying is a communal, what I feel is a shared communal drag. You know? No one wants to sit next to Kevin Smith, who doesn't want to sit next to the woman with the crying baby, who doesn't want to sit next to
the smelly guy.
The smelly guy, who doesn't want to sit next to the tall guy with broad shoulders and splays his leg, taking,
yeah.
you know. So it goes on and on, and I think this is just sort of writ large, if you will, the idea that fat people are supposed to take the blame for everything.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there are lots of people I don't want to sit next to on a plane.
Yeah.
But I accept it, and, you know, the airlines are to blame, the seats are to blame. I accept it as part of the contract of flying.
Mm-hmm.
We're all in this tube together, and nobody likes it.
Right. Yeah, definitely. And as far as miserable communal experiences, I kind of feel that way about mass as well. So,
right.
Kind of puts it in the same picture there. So, well, our time is almost up. So I want to ask you one more question. And
sure.
And if I would love to interview you again, this has been a blast. But my last question is, what would you tell the young you, the young woman struggling with her body image growing up? What would you tell her? What would you tell women today who struggle with their body image?
I would say life is too short. I would say figure out, do the necessary. I think we do have an obligation to take care of ourselves. Mm-hmm. For a lot of us, that does not translate into being a size 12. I mean, I exercise every day. My husband will tell you, I eat my vegetables. I don't, you know, on paper, I follow all the so-called rules. Mm-hmm. I know that I personally feel better psychologically and in physically when I work out and I eat more vegetables and candy, you know. Right. That's my experience. I don't want to impose that on anyone else. As we know, Shannon, there are lots of people out there, lots of women, men who are the, quote, right size, who are not healthy. Mm-hmm. So what I would want to tell that person is try to figure out how to listen to your body and then move on and have your life. Mm-hmm. Because I'm telling you, it will suck the life out of you, and pretty soon you'll realize that you have, you know, my mom is 76. God love her. She still goes to water aerobics. She watches what she eats. She's always going to be 5'1" and overweight. But she's still working on it, and I see what it's done to her life, that she views everything through that prism. If I just behave, or I'm going to do better today. Mm-hmm. At a certain point, I think you have to move on with your life and work in tandem with that. Like, do what you need to do, and then quit. You know, it's a form of idol worship, I think.
Right.
You know, it's just, it's it's wasted. Am I making any sense?
Absolutely. It's a never-ending quest, a never-ending futile quest.
Yes.
For someone else's ideal.
Right. Oh, God. You should interview yourself. But, yeah, because I get all like, hung up and emotional and verbose. But, you know, and you know who I'm absolutely adoring is, I don't know exactly how to pronounce her name. Gabri.
Oh, Sidibe. Yeah,
Sidibe.
Gabri Sidibe.
Yeah, I read this article with an interview with her, and she said at a certain point, I mean, she's a young woman, and she figured this out years ago. Mm-hmm. I figured out at a certain point I was just going to love me and I'd not worry about anyone else loving myself. And look at her. She's just walking around like, here I am.
She's walking around like, you know, as glamorous as Sandra Bullock was, or
yes,
you know, anybody
just,
else on the red carpet.
Right, and just loving the ride.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so I guess that's what...
I think we have to cross our fingers, though, that she doesn't succumb to the pressure. Cause,
you know, I have wondered if she, if eventually, you know, in a few years, we see her transformation story like Jennifer Hudson.
Yeah.
You know?
We'll see. We'll see where that goes.
But, you know, it's encouraging, because even at their skinniest, they're still
chubby,
nice and round.
Yeah,
you know, and I just want people to love themselves for who they are, and I want people to love me for the right reasons.
Yeah, I want people to love me too. So
yeah,
I think
that's a worthwhile quest for all of us.
All right, let's go. Let's go find some love then. Well, thank you very much, Mary.
You're
Jo
welcome.
Peel.
My pleasure.
This has been a pleasure, and I look forward to speaking to you again.
Very good. Thanks,
thank you very much.
Okay. Bye.
See the man with the stage fright, just standing up there to give it all his might. And he got caught in the spotlight. But when we get to the end, he wanna start off.